Good morning. Welcome to worship at First Presbyterian Church of Columbus, Georgia. We're glad that you're here to join us as we worship God by offering our prayers and singing songs and listening to Scripture. Please come in with us that we may worship God together.
Good morning and Happy New Year. And in a moment, I will begin with our call to worship. But again, I want to, and I'll do this again later, as a welcome to you all that are here, an appreciation as we begin this new year here. This is also one of those, I guess, unique days, interesting days. We have an opportunity to see both sacraments celebrated. So that's where you will see one pitcher to be used for the water, for the baptism, another for the sacrament of Holy Communion. And so today, as you observe and participate in the sacraments, I invite you to ponder in particular, beginning this new year, a chance to renew your own baptismal covenant, as well as recommit yourself through this sacrament. You, O Lord, are our strength and our shield, our rock and our salvation. You, O Lord, are holy, and you alone are perfect love, and you alone are perfect truth. And you, O Lord, you alone are worthy of our praise. Let us worship God.
Amen.
Please be seated. And why do we pray together? We are a community. If one of us suffers, we all suffer. If one of us rejoices, we all rejoice. Let us offer our prayers in unison. God of grace and truth, in Jesus Christ, you came among us as light shining in darkness. We confess that we have not welcomed the light or trusted good news to be good. We have closed our eyes to glory in our midst, expecting little and hoping for less. Forgive our doubt and renew our hope so that we may receive the fullness of your grace and live in the truth of Christ the Lord. Mercies always stand, and God's love always flows, and God's forgiveness always heals. Friends, hear and believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Seated. And any of you children like to come down and watch, they are invited to do so as we begin to celebrate the sacrament of baptism for Ivy June Carlisle, daughter of Alyssa and Max, and invite them to come forward along with the elder representing the session, Tom Carlisle, also known as Proud Grandfather. All right. Yeah, come on down. Have a seat right here. You could even sit on that pew if you want a better view, okay?
No, I had a couple of grandkids. Maybe I'll better
view. Okay. Hear the words of our Lord Jesus Christ. All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey all that I have commanded you. And remember, I am with you always to the end of the age. Yes. Obeying the word of our Lord Jesus Christ and confident of his promises, we baptize those whom God has called. In baptism, God claims us and seals us to show that we belong to God. God frees us from sin and death, uniting us with Jesus Christ in his death and resurrection. And by water and the Holy Spirit, we are made members of the church, the body of Christ, and joined to Christ's ministry of love, peace, and justice. Let us remember with joy our own baptism as we celebrate this sacrament today.
On behalf of this session, I present to you Ivy June Carlisle, the daughter of Alyssa and Max, to receive the sacrament of baptism.
Do you desire that Ivy June be baptized? Do you?
We do.
And relying on God's grace, do you promise to live the Christian faith and to teach that faith to Ivy June? Do you?
And do you, as members of the Church of Jesus Christ, promise to guide and nurture Ivy June by word and deed with love and prayer? Encourage her to know and follow Christ and to be a faithful member of Christ's church. Do you?
Let us now affirm our faith. The words are printed in your bulletin. Little child, for you, Jesus Christ came into the world. For you, he did battle, and for you, he suffered. For you, he went through the agony of Gethsemane and the darkness of Calvary. For you, he cried, "It is fulfilled." And for you, he triumphed over death. And you, little child, know nothing about this, but this is the statement of the apostle confirmed. We love God because God first loved us. Amen. Let us pray. We give thanks, eternal God, for you nourish and sustain all living things by the gift of water. In the beginning of time, your Spirit moved over the watery chaos, calling forth order and life. And in the time of Noah, you destroyed evil by the waters of the flood, giving righteousness a new beginning. You led Israel out of slavery through the waters of the sea into the freedom of the promised land. And in the waters of Jordan, Jesus was baptized by John and anointed with your Spirit. By the baptism of his own death and resurrection, Christ set us free from sin and death and opened the way to eternal life. Send your Spirit to move over this water that it may be a fountain of deliverance and rebirth. Wash away the sin of this child who was cleansed by it and raise her to new life and engraft her to the body of Christ. Pour out your Holy Spirit upon Ivy June, that she may have the power to do your will and continue forever in the risen life of Christ. To you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God, be praise and honor and glory now and forevermore. Amen. There we go. Ivy June, baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Ivy June, child of the covenant, you are marked by the Holy Spirit as belonging to Christ forevermore. Amen. And now the time to present and share this young girl with you all. Now I can remember, he has no recollection, but I can remember Max, she was four years old when y'all were here the first time. and he could actually jump up, and I could hold him. It took two arms, but I could hold him. He's being trained to be a ranger. He could probably hold me and pick me up and parade me around. But in those early years, this church nurtured him and his sister. And because home is wherever Uncle Sam sends you, the Carlisles, and I won't even try to recount the journeys, but y'all went to many places and then came back here. And their children were here, and their children have gone for their own adventures and places. And now they are married, and I'm going to get you back, don't worry. And now they're here. And young Max is with the Army, and home will be wherever Uncle Sam sends you all. For now, it's here. And so for now, we have this window where we can nurture. And it's a wonderful opportunity that we have wherever they go next, and if they're even brought back here, because it happens. As we know, folks have come back. But thanks be to God for our newest addition. Amen.
Ivy June has been received into the one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church through baptism. God has made her a member of the household of God to share with us in the priesthood of Christ. Let us welcome the newly baptized using the words printed in your bulletin. With joy and thanksgiving, we welcome you into Christ's church.
And I'll begin welcome and announcements at this time. Any children that wish to go to Children's Church may do so, or wish to remain, you may do that as well. Again, I want to welcome all of you here. We're not televised today, but a record has been kept of this. So for the family, y'all will have a record of this. So I'm just going to welcome you all. I ask you to sign the attendance pad at the end of your pew, pass it back to the point of origin. And I believe we do have a few more refreshments. They may have been left out there, maybe not. But anyway, do share and greet one another following this worship service. This does begin the new year, and there's much in front of us. We hit the ground running this week. I want to invite you on Wednesday, church family supper, and following that is our service of healing and wholeness. This year, we're going to experiment. We're going to do it in the chapel. So if you come to the sanctuary, you're going to be in a dark room. I invite you to come to the chapel for that service of healing and wholeness. About 6:30 is when we begin it. It's a wonderful way as we begin our new year. Next Sunday, we're back to two worship services with Sunday school in between. In it together, we'll be reconvening. Are you all still working on Martin Luther? A new class, okay. So speak with Mark Jarrell following the worship service as to what your new topic will be. Mike Stewart, some of you remember him. He has taught before in the Center for Christian Studies. He will be leading a series in January, the 8th through the 29th, on the life of David. So he'll be teaching that for Center for Christian Studies. That will be in the parlor, and Reverend Alvis's class that he has been convening will gather again in the museum. So we begin regularly with Sunday school. The following Wednesday, we are back on Stephanie Boaz. Many of you all know her. On Wednesday nights, she'll be leading a Bible study for the next three Wednesdays to follow in January. Many people, I'm going to get it, don't worry. So she'll be leading that. Yes, it was on my list, don't worry. But Jim Campbell, holy cow, there's Jim Campbell. You know, are you going to speak about this?
Let me just mention one thing. Okay. Since we're not on TV or anything, you've got in your book the information about some what we're calling kind of listening conferences. This is not the same thing at all as David Moore came and presented in the fellowship hall last year. That was kind of the overall results of the survey, the Holy Cow survey. This is very specific, about an hour, maybe an hour and 10 minutes. dealing with the three topics that were most frequently mentioned by the congregation as areas of opportunity and things to pursue. So the schedule is here. They're designed to be fairly small classes, maybe 15, 20 members, and that's why we're doing the sign-up. And I think it's in the Johnson Hall, and if you would take a look at that and sign up for that. If you're not able to come to any of these, we plan on having, depending on the needs, some follow-up after that pretty quickly. Please come to one of these. It's very important. It will be an important guidance for the pastoral nominating committee that will be undertaking the search for our next senior pastor. So,
and again, in case you did not hear, it's in the bulletin. Holy Cow Gatherings. You can sign up to attend one. The material was debriefed with us, has already been debriefed with us. This is taking the top three concerns or opportunities and taking them to the next level. And was emphasized that this is part of that learning process about our congregation of what we want, where we think that God is leading us, will help the pastor nominating committee as they begin their work in the year.
One thing I forgot. Don't not come to one of these meetings because you didn't take the survey. Okay? You're encouraged to come whether or not you took the survey, so please take that opportunity.
Again, as said, even if you did not participate in the survey, your attendance is appreciated and would be helpful, again, as we take it to the next level. I believe that concludes our announcements. Let us pause and then sing, remain seated, but sing our hymn for illumination, Go Tell It on the Mountain. Our first lesson today comes from Psalm 90 in selected verses. This begins the fourth book. Actually, the Psalms are divided into five books. Bit of trivia there. I won't say it's trivial, but bit of information there. And this begins the fourth one. Listen now to the Word of God. Lord, you have been our dwelling place in all generations. Before the mountains were brought forth, or ever you had formed the earth and the world, from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. You turn us back to dust and say, turn back, you mortals, for 1,000 years in your sight are like yesterday when it is past, or like a watch in the night. You sweep them away and they are like a dream, like grass that is renewed in the morning. In the morning it flourishes and is renewed, and in the evening it fades and withers. The days of our life are 70 years, or perhaps 80 if we are strong. And even then their span is only toil and trouble. They are soon gone and we fly away. So teach us to count our days that we may gain a wise heart. And this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our second lesson comes from the book of Philippians, picking up in chapter 3, verse 12. Listen now to the Word of God. Paul writes when he says, "Not that I have already obtained this or have already reached the goal, but I press on to make it my own because Christ Jesus has made me his own. Beloved, I do not consider that I have made it my own, but this one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead, I press on toward the goal for the prize of the heavenly call of God in Christ Jesus." And this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Whenever I have preached on New Year's Day or on a Sunday that has come close to New Year's Day, and that could actually be very late December or very early January, there are two images that come to my mind and two stories to which I always return, it seems, when I'm speaking, preaching on such a day as today. The first one comes from, I'm going to say, December 1986. It was very close to Christmas, maybe the 22nd, something like that. I was in Charlotte for a reason. I was there to see a good friend of mine, and we were having lunch at his mother's condominium. And it was pretty close, like I said, to Christmas, so that we were already talking about New Year's plans as well. And it was interesting listening to his mother, because I knew that she had been in her life to many festive New Year's Eve parties. Many a time she had pulled out the ball gown and had been, again, black tie events and maybe dinner parties with friends, a variety of New Year's Eve celebrations in which she had participated. Well, that year she was looking forward to staying at home. She said, I've kind of done it all. This year I just want to sit in my chair and watch the ball come down on Times Square. And I'm not going to make any resolutions because I always break them. But I am going to make a special wish for each of my children into the coming year. Now, for the oldest one, was married, and she said, they need to have a baby. So that's my wish for them. She didn't consult with them, but that was her wish for them. For number two, she needs to find somebody and get married. So that was going to be her wish for daughter number two. For daughter number three and third child, she said she just needs to settle down and do something. Now, this was someone who had held a variety of jobs, who had done them well. There was never a question of her competence. I mean, she did well at the job, but she would get bored or just want to do something else, and so she would take on another job. And so that was, that was her hope, is that she'll just find a job she really likes, can do it well, and just stays with it. And then for my friend, her wish for him was good health. He had not really had bad health that fall, but he had this lingering cold that just never would quite go away. It would get better and then would come back. And so that was her wish for him. And I liked that idea of having a wish for people for the new year. And that has stayed with me over time, kind of an aspiration somewhere between a resolution and a goal, something to pursue in the coming year. That story comes to mind as I look at our scriptures for today. And starting with our passage from the Psalms. Now, I learned that verse, that section, that last verse that I read this way, to teach us to number our days that we might gain a heart of wisdom. That was the purpose, that was the prayer of that psalm. A prayer for us is that we would use our time well and strategically, and not just good time management. Now, I think many of us have made time management resolutions over the years, and some have worked, some have had to return to that. I've got my own kind of list of some time management strategies I'm going to try in the coming year. I've got a short list of new practices. It's more than just that. Teach us to number our days that we might gain a heart of wisdom. It's a prayer for us, a wish for us to gain wisdom from our past year. To look at the challenges that we have faced, the opportunities that we have taken. Sometimes there have been a road that we have followed, and sometimes there's been a road we've not taken. To assess that, what did we learn? What did we gain from that? And take it forward going into this new year. If someone were to sit down with me, I'll kind of go ahead and give you a preview of what a pastoral counseling session would be like. If someone were to sit down with me and talk about a mistake that they had made, path that shouldn't have taken or something that was done, and they're kind of more than confessing, they're confessing and saying, where do we go forward from that? My question would be, well, did you learn anything? And depending on the nature, maybe even a kind of a humorous way, and sometimes it might be very serious. What have you learned from this? Is there something you've gained from this to help you do better in the year ahead or the time ahead? How is God going to redeem this situation? And so that is my prayer for us. What have we learned to go forward? It's been interesting reading people's reviews of 2016. For some, it's been a terrible year, and they list all of these reasons why. For some, it's been a good year. For me personally, it's been a good year. I've had fun, quite frankly. I've had fun with my family. We have done some great things, and we've had some less than ideal moments, but I'm going to look back on 2016 favorably. Personally, it's been a good year. And some of you are like that personally, 2016 was good. Professionally, or in this area, I've seen better. And it might be the reverse. Some of you have had professionally, good years that at home just was not the best and you would not want to repeat. From this, what have I learned? How can we go forward? And with that in mind, I'm looking at Paul's letter to the Philippians and the things that he had to say to them where he looked back and he looked forward. Now, some of you already know this, but it's going to repeat. Paul wrote this letter in prison. The people of the church in Philippi, a city in modern-day Greece, had given him a gift, had collected an offering, and had sent it to him. And so, his mama raised him right. You write a thank you note. And of course, that is the way you communicate in those days, long distance, by notes and letters. And so, let's take this as an opportunity to write some more words of advice and encouragement to them. Essentially, the church was doing pretty well, so there's not many major issues that are described. And they're not perfect, and that's alluded. But he uses that as an opportunity to speak to them. And again, he's in prison, so he's got a lot of time on his hands. But it's interesting as he talks about his situation, he talked about his opportunities. He had a guard that was chained to him. They took turns. And so he's got an opportunity. He literally has a captive audience as an opportunity to talk about Jesus Christ with the different guards. And I guess some were interested, some were not, but they began to talk, the guards began to talk amongst themselves. And he said, what a wonderful opportunity I have. He also said that because I cannot be out and about teaching and preaching, others are doing it. Now for some, they're saying, gosh, Paul can't do it. I need to pick up the slack. And he's grateful for that. And then for others, they're thinking, that Paul thinks he's so big and now he can't get out. I'm going to do it, and I'll bet it just makes him pea green with envy. And Paul basically says, you know what? The Lord is being proclaimed. It's no skin, no skin off of me. More power to them. As a side note, it reminds me, God can redeem tacky behavior. And for me, that is good news, that even tacky behaviors out there, God can somehow take those, renew them, and use them for the glory. So that's the perspective that he is given and what's going on. And as part of his letter, he reviews his past, telling his story. And remember that Paul, as a rabbi, He was a hot shot. He was a top gun. He was just the Harvard MBA. If there was a magazine, Four Under 40, among the rabbis, he had been on the cover. He was a sharp guy. And he had the heritage. He's aware of his bloodlines. He knows his tribe. He is part of the tribe of Benjamin. And he knows his heritage. As I've said elsewhere in times about Paul, he knows he's a Roman citizen, and he's very proud of that. And he's very comfortable in the Greek culture. He could go from city to city and know exactly what to do and what to say and when to say it. And so he does have a value on the gifts that God has given him. But at the same time, he can say, it's a gift, but I'm beyond that. What I pursue is Christ. And compared to that pursuit, all these other things, they're like rubbish. He doesn't really, really devalue them, but he knows what his ultimate value is. And he wants to look forward. And that's what he's talking about in the section that I read. Forgetting what lies behind, I am going forward. Despite everything that has happened, I am going forward. He values his past, but not captive to the past. He wants to use it. Just for a moment to look at our own church as we begin this new year. And Jim, I'm going to give another commercial for Holy Cow that was already pre-planned in the sermon. We have a pastor nominating committee has been elected. And for those that were present that Sunday that you all elected them, we even had a laying on of hands. They've had one preparation meeting. They've got a little more training to go. But basically, they're going to get to work here in January. They're going to hit the ground running. And pray for them because y'all going to work hard, okay? I see a member right there. And when they call a pastor, no one's going to be yelling hallelujah more than they are when that work is done. They have this task in front of them, and we have that opportunity to participate in those Holy Cow conversations. That is part of the process of how do we go forward in a way, forgetting things that lay behind us, focusing on where we're going. We have our usual work here at the church. Give a commercial for the mission conference that kicks off a month from today, February 1st. It's a Wednesday night. Our usual mission conference, except it's mission emphasis, excuse me. Just remember, we're changing our terminology. It's the mission emphasis. It's taking off in this new year. Now, this is also a season where different ministry teams are kind of reevaluating different projects and programs and saying, where do we want to be with certain things, and that's good. That's part of the process. I'm not going to go through an exhaustive list right now. This is a season for this church to reevaluate and to plan, to think ahead. Where are we going? That is part of that prayer of number our days. Give us a heart of wisdom. Help us to learn from the past and use our time wisely. And this, like I said, I've been speaking about the church, but this is also something for your own life. Lord, this has been my past year. These have been my highs. These have been my lows. What are you teaching me through this? And how do I go forward? In whatever ways that God is calling you, particularly in terms of your faith, or ways that God's calling you just to serve wherever you find yourself, in your community, in your workplace, ways that God is at work. Well, I told you there were two stories, and I shared the first one of the friend's mother and her wishes for the children. The other one is a story from the mid-1970s, and it was New Year's Eve 1974 going into 1975. A family, a couple, were planning a New Year's Eve party, and they had this great kind of theme idea, but realized it was not going to work. And so in their conversation with the adult daughter, and she said, look, you know, 1974, it was not a great year, and listed several of the downers of that year, and some of you all would remember that and particular reasons. And they said 1974 was not a good year. 1975 is not going to be any better, I don't think. What's there to celebrate? And so they said, aha, that's it. This is going to be our party. Come as your favorite year. Thinking, well, 1975 won't be so great. Well, let's bring out a past year. And so they did. And it was funny to see the different guests come. The adult daughter came as 1961, her year of being a teenager. One fellow came as 1952. One woman came as 1945, her freshman year at college, and some wonderful adventures that she had that year. One fellow even came as 1942. Because he was young and he knew I'm part of this bigger thing as we basically fight this great evil. I am part of this great thing. And he was young and so much was out in front of him at that time. Well, as will often happen as you get in that discussion about years, people began to challenge, well, what year was so great about that? Okay, yeah, 1942, there was a war going on. What was so great about that? Yeah, it was good for you personally, but what about that? Oh, 1952, it wasn't that good a year after all. And the mother told the daughter, who had loved 1961, do you know what it was like to have a teenage daughter in 1961? That was a terrible year for me. And it began this debate. Well, then an older guest spoke up. She had come to the party kind of along with another couple. She was 94 years old, and she said, kind of, I'm tired of you all arguing. And she said, you know what? As opposed to toasting your favorite year, I want to toast my favorite minute. And that minute is now. Because she said at 94, every minute is a gift. Every moment is a gift. And as they wished one another, kind of getting that moment of truth had happened to all of them, and they're wishing each other a happy new year as it was rolling into 75, she just says, happy now. Happy now. You have your own evaluations, the best of times, the worst of times, combination thereof. For some, it's been a memorable year. For some, it may have been a disastrous year. And for some, it may have been a basic year. Some good, some bad. It's a good, overall, you're going to say positive, but nothing, you know, exceptional for the Christmas newsletter. Just a good, just a basic year. This year is a gift. And forgetting what lies behind, let's press onward to what we have before us. Let us press onward and teach us to number our days that we might gain a heart of wisdom. Thanks be to God. Amen. Please be seated and let us continue our worship as we present to God our tithes, our offerings, our gifts, and our very selves. Gracious God, you are our provider, and your grace is sufficient for us. We give back to you a part of what you have given to us. May this in turn provide for others. In your gracious and good name we pray. Amen. Please be seated. And so we once again come to this table, coming to this table on the first day of our new year. And Jesus Christ himself serves as host. This is not the table of First Presbyterian or of the Presbyterian Church. This is the Lord's table. All have been baptized and trust in Christ as Savior, are repentant of your sins. You are invited. You are welcomed to this New Year's feast. And see the words now printed in your bulletin. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Almighty, gracious, and loving God, we give thanks that we are brought together again here to this place, here to this table, here on this particular day. And today we remember your acts of salvation in Jesus Christ, God the Son, his birth that he might live among us, and his life which showed us how to live, his death which paid the penalty of sin, and his resurrection which conquered the power of sin and death, and the promise of his return. By the power of the Holy Spirit, draw us into the presence of the risen Christ, so that we may be fed, that we may be joined in the communion of saints to all of your people everywhere, and may we be sent forth as faithful disciples. All praise be to you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And we pray now with the confidence of the children of God, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And hear now these words of institution. For I received from the Lord what I handed on to you, that the night when the Lord Jesus was betrayed, he took the bread, and when after he had given thanks, he broke it, and he said, This is my body, broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same manner, he took the cup after supper, saying, This is my blood shed in the new covenant for you. Every time you drink it, do this in remembrance of me. Every time that you eat this bread, and every time you drink from this cup, you proclaim the saving death of the risen Lord until he comes again. In a moment, I will call forth the elders to serve. We will celebrate by intinction. Please leave from your left and come down to a station here and re-enter your pew by the right. There will be three stations here. Amelia, for your group, then the wing, if you all will go first, followed by you all here. Second station, you will have one here, and you all will come and gather over there. As you get towards the back of the lot, if those of you at the back, if you come down and you see a station that's emptied, it's okay. You can come over and cut over and take from that one. Would the elders please come forward? The gifts of God for the people of God, come. In this sacrament, we celebrate the fact that we're at peace with God and one another. So invite you to share the peace by saying, "The peace of Christ be with you," and then respond, "And also with you." Share the peace. As a charge today, I want to share, best I can from memory, words that King George VI gave to the British people and to the Commonwealth and the Empire from the Christmas message of 1939. And he said, "I said to the man at the gate of the new year, 'Show me a light that I may go into the darkness.' And the man said, 'Put your hand into the hand of God, and that will be a better way than any light.' As we go forth into the new year, may we put our hand into the hand of God, guiding us forward. And now may the love of God our Father, and the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all, both now and forevermore. Amen."
Thank you.
It's been a privilege to join you this day in worship. We're glad that you were here. First Presbyterian Church seeks to serve and minister in the name of Jesus Christ. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord be kind and gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with favor. Go in peace as you love and serve God.